calls for fencing are next right here on ESPN. For Agent Carson and Brian Drever, I'm Robin Roberts. We'll see you soon.
Centuries ago, the sword was used in duels to the death, defending love, honor, and country. Hollywood's portrayal was one of action and adventure. Today, fencing is a tactical game of speed, focus, and finesse. And for the few who succeed, a chance at Olympic glory.
And now, your host, Robin Roberts.
Good evening again, everyone. An indication of the quality of international competition in fencing is this fact. America's 13-time national champion, Peter Westbrook, has managed to win but one bronze medal in five Olympic outings. Westbrook will be trying for the team again this year. But perhaps the women have the best chance for a medal in the foil competition, in which the torso is a target. America's Anne Marsh, ranked among the top 12 in the world, has already qualified. Let's go out to Chris Marlowe and Carl Borak in Cincinnati, Ohio.
You're looking at Riverfront Stadium, where the Cincinnati Reds play baseball. We're right around the corner here at the Cincinnati Convention Center. We are all set for the U.S. Olympic fencing trials. Carl Borak, you are the non-playing captain of the 1996 Olympic fencing team. What can we look for in this competition?
Chris, most of the fencers you will see have already made the Olympic team. They've been competing all year long in domestic events and World Cup competition. And because of great international results, they've already made the team. They're a very compelling mix of talented young fencers combined with seasoned veterans.
And speaking of experience, meet 37-year-old Michael Marks, a five-time Olympian. On top of that, six-time Olympian Peter Westbrook. Earlier, Westbrook talked about being one of America's cagey veterans.
I'm one of those kind of guys, most of the field in their 20s. I am 44, but I have so much experience. I just came back from a tournament in Madrid, and I almost beat the Olympic champion, and people were really nervous. So I'm not favored to win a medal, but I know if I'm hot that day, I know that I can beat anybody in the world.
Peter Westbrook was the last American to win a medal in fencing. That was back in 1984 when he won a bronze. What kind of a chance does he have in Atlanta?
Peter Westbrook is certainly a long shot in Atlanta, but you can never count this guy out. He has extraordinary reflexes and still has one of the fastest hands in the game. Last year at the Pan American Games, he won a gold medal defeating a Cuban 20 years younger than him and anchored the U.S. team to a gold medal.
How does an inner city kid from New Jersey get turned on to fencing? Hollywood movies.
I got my interest in fencing through watching Zorro. Zorro was my hero. I wanted to be like Zorro. I used to fantasize myself in church. I went to the Catholic church, closing my eyes. It'd be nice if I could swing in the church and save one of these nuns. So every Halloween, one of them good-looking nuns, all with all due respect. And I had a fantasy to live out my life and actually be a swashbuckler.
To qualify for the Olympic team, all Peter Westbrook had to do in this competition was make the final eight, and Zorro's protege did. Men's saber rules. The target area is the upper body. Thrusting action gets you a point, so does cutting action with the blade. And the first fencer to score 15 points wins the match. The fencing surface is called the strip. And if you're an American and you're not into the metric system, it's 44 feet long and 6 feet wide. The on-guard lines, that's where the two fencers start their action. We now move to semifinal action of the saber competition. One Olympic berth remains in saber. Will it be New Yorker Michael DeSaro here on the near side, or that man, 24-year-old Polish-born Tomek Strzalkowski? The scene is simple for DeSaro. He must win this bout to keep his Olympic hopes alive. Interestingly, his opponent, Peter Cox, has already made the Olympic team via domestic and international competition the past year, but still would like to win the national championship and carries with him a very special motivation in every bout.
2 years ago, I lost my younger brother, who's 7 years younger. Right before he passed away, he did say something to me. He said that, I can't wait to go to Atlanta and see you. And then he said, I'll see you there no matter what. and he died. And it was very difficult. I'd never thought about death before. I think it would be very upsetting for anyone to lose someone that you're that close to. But it forced me to even look closer at the things I'd been doing to train to get to the Olympics and to win a medal, which was my mental game. It forced me to every day work on my visualization, to work on my meditation, to put things and have a place for them, and to find a place for Mark.
Let's pick up the semifinal. Peter Cox leading Michael DeSaro 12-8. Now make it 12-9 as DeSaro scores on attack.
Very tough lead to overcome. Three touches and all this pressure on Michael's shoulders. He's got a very hard road here. Simultaneous action here, no touch.
Score remains 12-9. Peter Cox with the lead. And Cox scores to make it 13-9. Cox is 29 years old. He was the 1989 NCAA Sabre champion at Penn State. Now lives in Overland Park, Kansas.
Angad, ready, finish.
Another simultaneous action, no touch.
Angad, ready, finish.
Paul DeSaro scores again on attack. Remember, the match is to 15.
One thing to keep in mind, Peter Cox has been bothered by a sore toe the whole tournament. You can see right here that he's having trouble with his footing.
Nearly slips right off the strip. And perhaps limping just a bit. 13-10 is our score. DeSaro scores on a cut. That makes it 13-11 now. And a very nervous Tomek Strzelkowski. And it's 13-12. DeSaro just 1 point behind. Remember, Tomek Strzelkowski needs Peter Cox to win to send him to the Olympic Games.
Ready? Finish.
And DeSaro scores again. That makes it 14-13.
DeSaro's making an incredible comeback. His emotion is carrying him all the way through this bout.
He was down 12-8 at one point. Now he was 1 point away.
Together, not done.
Another simultaneous attack. No touch.
Angad, ready, finish.
And that's it. DeSaro wins it.
Goodbye, gentlemen.
Tomek Strzelkowski, who was knocked out of the competition in an early round match. He needed help from his former Penn State teammate, Peter Cox, and didn't get it. What a performance by 31-year-old Michael DeSaro.
DeSaro fence with tremendous poise considering all the pressure he had.
Father Michael Sr. was a member of the 1960 Olympic team and coach of the 1976 Olympic team, and apparently the apple does not roll far from the tree. The fate of Michael DeSaro and Tomek Strzelkowski after this. Back at the U.S. Olympic fencing trials, we're now ready for the Sabre final. Michael DeSaro and Adam Skarbonkovic. Skarbonkovic cannot be an Olympian because he is not yet an American citizen. However, he is a resident and will be eligible to do battle with DeSaro in this one. The pressure definitely on DeSaro. He talked about how he handles it.
I tried to work on mostly mental training. Every now and then, whenever I lax, I put too much pressure on myself. I start thinking, wow, I have to make this team. I get really tight and I do very bad. But if I can just tell myself that I just go bout by bout and relax, have a good time, and the fencing just comes naturally.
Let's pick up the Sabre final. Skarbonkovic leads DeSaro 14-11. DeSaro on the left, and DeSaro scores. Make it 14-12. Could DeSaro do it again? And it's 14-13. DeSaro pulls to within one. No, it's counted a double touch. And Strzelkowski dying on the sidelines. So the score remains 14-12. Skarbonkovic. Now it is 14-13. And Peter Westbrook liking what he saw. Garbankovic still leads it, however, 14-13. The bout is to 15. Garbankovic wins it. And Tomek Strakowski is going to the Olympics. And Michael DeSauro is not.
A very disappointing defeat for Michael DeSauro. It was a tremendous tournament for him. He had all the pressure on his shoulders more than anybody else in the tournament. And he came all the way only to lose by two touches.
An elated Tomek Strakowski. He is going to the Olympic Games courtesy of his fellow countryman, Adam Garbankovic, who wins the national championship. A valiant effort by Michael DeSauro, the kid from New York. Unfortunately, it was not enough to get him to Atlanta. Let's go down to the floor and Carl Borick.
You had to come in and win, and you took it all the way up to this last bout. What was going through your mind as you went onto that strip?
Like I said, I was just trying to stay relaxed, trying not to think about the team. You know, if I win, that happens. My job is just to stay relaxed and fence as best I could, try and move. The win or lose is the last bout of the day, so I had to give it my all. And I did. Just wasn't enough today.
The United States Olympic Sabre team, Peter Cox Jr., Peter Westbrook, and a very relieved Tomek Strakowski.
Continues Friday with rhythmic gymnastics at 7:30 on ESPN.
Chris Marlowe and Carl Borack back in Cincinnati, Ohio, here at the U.S. Olympic fencing trials. The U.S. women's foil team has already been selected, and it should be one of America's best ever. Ann Marsh, ranked 11th in the world currently, the highest ranking ever achieved by a U.S. fencer. She's joined by Felicia Zimmerman, the 1995 Junior World Cup champion, and Suzanne Paxton. For women's foil, the target area is the torso. You score with a point. Only in the first fencer to score 15 points wins a match. Let's pick up a very interesting match. Suzanne Paxton and, yes, Felicia Zimmerman. Zimmerman, 20 years old. She was the first alternate for the women's foil team in Barcelona back in 1992. Meanwhile, Suzanne Paxton, 26 years old, a graduate of Penn State University. They know each other well, don't they?
Susie and Felicia have been training together all year. They know each other's style, but they're using this tournament as a warm-up for the Olympics. They and Ann Marsh are more than teammates.
It all centers around a White House on the outskirts of Rochester, New York, dubbed the Foil House. Its tenants, Jane Hall, Susie Paxton, Felicia Zimmerman, and Ann Marsh. Together, they form the highly regarded U.S. women's foil team.
So, I think Iris mentioned that we're all going over your house sometime. Yeah? So you're gonna have a barbecue for us or something? Yeah, is your dad gonna cook?
Yes, I do.
Excellent. So when's this happening?
But why Rochester, and why the same house?
We needed a main training base, and we needed all of us at the same place.
If you're talking about a basketball team, volleyball team, the whole team will train together and be together or live in a dorm together or whatever their situation is, and they will compete together against another team. For fencing, they all live together, but they compete against each other.
And so, what do you want to drink?
What do you got?
Skim milk, apple cider, grape juice.
No, it's Concord grape.
I think it could have gone either way. It could have been a disaster. It could have gone really, really well, and I think we all made it work.
Guys, first of all.
And
the house has an average age of 24 and helps breathe new life into a sport that threatened to die away in the United States. They're led by Ann Marsh, whose intense attitude fuels a growing confidence in a fledgling team that not so long ago was considered second tier.
We've never been traditionally strong, and so my goal over a long period of time was to be one of the best in the world.
She has great attack. She's so aggressive, and she does not let the opponent think for one second.
Yeah.
The opponent's like, wait, oh, oh,
I just got hit. Oh, wait, what? What's happening now? Oh, I got hit again.
Getting a really nice touch is just a great feeling for me. And feeling like I'm one of the best in the world.
Doing a good job. You gotta learn how to do it because you're really good.
And Marsh certainly a role model for the younger American fencers.
Ira Zimmerman took the world of fencing by storm last year when at 14 years old, she won the Cadet World Championships, the first ever world championship for a U.S. fencer.
Watching my sister win was great. Even when I speak about it now, I want to cry. It was just wonderful seeing her up on the stand, watching the American flag go up, hearing our national anthem being played at a world championships, and everyone else from those dominating fencing powers around the world just watching in awe, you know, that there's an American up there.
Joining Iris and Felicia in America's youth movement are Monique DeBruin, a junior world finalist, and Sarah Walsh, an alternate to this year's Olympic team. This is the future of U.S. fencing. Watch for these kids in the year 2000.
However, the future is now for Ann Marsh, Felicia Zimmerman, and Suzanne Paxton. They are going to Atlanta. Welcome back to the U.S. Olympic fencing trials. Chris Marlowe along with team captain Carl Borak. We are getting set for a great matchup in men's foil. Cliff Baer, the defending national champion from New York City, New York, going up against the man he beat a year ago, Nick Braven. Both were recently featured in the Olympic edition of Vanity Fair. Braven and Baer, earlier, both of them talked about their sizzling rivalry.
If I come up against my teammate Nick, I think it'll be fun. We'll have a good bout, and it'd be great if we get to fence for the gold like we did last year.
I like my chances. I think I'm fencing well. Cliff's also fencing very well. I mean, the ideal situation would be to have a great bout where no one gets hurt and for me to win.
One of the most eagerly awaited matches of the Olympic trials and the national championships. Remember, both have already made the Olympic team and will be teammates in Atlanta. But right now it's war. We pick it up with Braven leading Baer 13-11. The parents of Cliff Baer watching anxiously. So far, Braven has been in command. To 11. Now Nick Braven, the former three-time champ, 1 point away.
Braven is really hungry to win this bout. He makes a beautiful counter parry repost and scores on the back. That's a defensive action, establishing his right away and scoring with the touch.
Baer scores. That makes it 14-12. Nick Braven, who had an 11-8 lead last year on Baer and ended up losing. Baer scores again on attack, and it's 14-13. Suffice it to say, Baer's mom is into it. Braven, however, still leads by 114-13.
Off target touch. Nothing happened.
Ready, fence. And Braven wins it. 15-13. The new national champion. Cliff Baer's effort was good enough. Not this time, Carl.
Nick was really hungry for this match. He needed a victory, and it's a great warm-up for Atlanta.
Braven, a native of Los Angeles, California, wins his fourth national championship. He is with Carl Borak.
For you, it must be sweet revenge.
Yeah, sweet revenge. I'm getting a lot of ribbing from my friends in New York talking about this little kid who beat me last year. I finally get to go back. Maybe they'll even see it on TV, but I finally get to go back and tell him I won. And for me, it's been a long time coming. We've had some real battles this year, and the first one I've eked out, so definitely sweet.
Going to Atlanta, Cliff Baer, Peter Devine, and on TV's Nick Braben.
ESPN's coverage of the U.S. Olympic trials is brought to you by Courtyard by Marriott, the hotel designed by business travelers.
Back in Cincinnati, Ohio, at the U.S. Olympic trials, one of the great stories in American fencing, that man, Michael Marks, a five-time Olympian. In addition to competing, he coaches Leslie, yes, his wife, in women's épée. And Leslie has made a meteoric rise in World Cup competition. Together, they strive to be the best, not only in the world, but in their own house. Check it out.
There's no contest with her, because if she does better since I'm a coach, it means I'm a better coach.
Oh, but wait a second. You called from France after the Poitiers World Cup to say, oh, now I have two World Cup finals, and I think maybe, Leslie, you only have one World Cup final. And to which I respond, excuse me, but my result was a medal, and you only have two finals, and I have four lifetime finals.
So it goes back and forth.
Michael and Leslie are prime examples of the kind of sacrifice the U.S. fencers make to earn a spot on the Olympic team. Little or no money, personal and professional lives put on hold, just the desire to be the best in the sport they love.
The women's épée Olympians, Leslie Marks, Elaine Cherish, and Nilan Lee. For the men, James Carpenter, Michael Marks, and Tamir Bloom. Carl, final thoughts.
Watch out for the U.S. fencing team. They're on the rise.
There were many exciting moments here in Cincinnati. The U.S. fencers hope there'll be more in Atlanta.
So this team hopes to thrust and carry its way toward America's first Olympic medal in fencing since 1984. Join us this evening live at 7:30 p.m. Eastern on ESPN2 as USA Baseball hopes to avenge its loss to Japan in the 92 Olympic bronze medal game. For Chris Marlowe and Carl Borak, I'm Robin Roberts. Thanks for joining us, everyone. We'll see you soon.